I think it was right around 37 weeks that we maybe started having a hint that something wasn't quite right. I'd went in for my weekly appointment, and I'd mentioned to the doctor that the baby wasn't moving very much. And he said, okay, and he said, I'll just hook you up to the monitor here and see what's happening. And he hooked me up to the monitor and found the baby's heartbeat right away. And it was very, what I now know, just to kind of be flat. It was just steady at 150, the baby wasn't moving. But I didn't think anything of it. And I remember saying to Craig, oh, I think he, you know, he's not moving very much. Craig goes, oh, he's probably sleeping. And Craig came over and kind of said, made a noise at my stomach, and the baby kicked. He did move suddenly, and right at the time, his heart rate started to, what they call a deceleration. And it started to kind of decrease, and then it gradually came back up and even back out. And the doctor came in soon after and kind of looked at it. He didn't say anything at the time, but I remember saying, okay, well, I'm gonna send you over to the hospital for an ultrasound and some further monitoring. So we went over to the hospital. I laid up on the table and they checked everything out. What they did, what's called a biophysical profile, and they checked his, you know, lung activity, and he was moving so much in my fluid level. And she said he did great. He passed. He got the 8 out of 8 that they do. And she sent me to the labor and delivery floor where they do the monitoring. And we got put into probably a triage room, just where they monitor. And I was hooked up to a monitor, and Craig and I were chatting away, having a great time, listening to his heartbeat. You know, not a concern in the world. And I remember the nurse did come in at one point, and she said, well, I want you to push this button every time that you feel a move. And I wasn't feeling a move, but his heart rate was steady. And I clearly remember her coming in and pushing very hard on my stomach to, what she said, wake him up and to get him moving. And then he did. He started to move. He started to kick a little bit more, and kind of. And then he didn't. I guess I don't know. Looking back, I don't know if he had any more decelerations. I wasn't told. I didn't know enough to look. And so they came in and said I was free to go. Everything checked out. I remember the next appointment. Our doctor was not there for. He was on vacation or whatever. And we saw another doctor. She put the Doppler on my stomach to listen to the heartbeat. And the heartbeat was really high. It was like up to like 170, 180, which he never was. He was always 150. And I remember thinking, wow, that's really fast. And it was so different than anything I'd heard before. And so that was kind of, you know, some inkling right there, looking back in hindsight. Was Curtis trying to tell us something? He was starting to give us some warning signs that things were maybe not quite right. I had a couple weird, I don't want to call them premonitions, that something wasn't quite right with the whole situation, the whole pregnancy, the whole baby thing. I never told anybody at the time, and I told people after, and I don't know how much people believe me or if I would have even said it at the time if they would have believed me, but I remember being about 36 weeks pregnant or so, and we had the room completely finished. I went in there to sit in the rocking chair, and I was kind of looking around, and this thought just popped in my head out of nowhere that said, there'll never be a baby in here. It was really random. It wasn't like some nervous thing that I was nervous about having a baby. I wasn't fearful of becoming a parent. I was, you know, I was excited about it. I wasn't scared. So it wasn't a scared thought. It just honestly felt like something was telling me that something wasn't right. Brushed it aside, never told anybody. And then it was about, maybe about 2 weeks later, I was about 38 weeks pregnant, I was talking with HR at my work about my maternity leave. And I clearly remember the thought popping into my head that this is completely stupid. You're gonna have to go to back to work early. Once again, it just kind of caught me off guard. I shook it off. It came out of nowhere and it left very quickly, but I don't know if that's what mother's intuition's all about. I don't know if it's a divine power trying to warn me. I honestly have no idea, but they obviously didn't listen to it. And I don't know, I'm a big believer in trusting your gut instinct, and maybe I, you know, ignored something I should have tried to push about. But it was Memorial Day weekend that I noticed he was very quiet. I believe it was a Sunday. Craig and I went up to a local park, and we were driving into the park, and we were kind of starting to wander around this trail area with our dog, and I kind of poked at my stomach, and I said, are you okay in there? You're pretty quiet. You still doing okay? And Craig made the comment, that's not funny. He's fine. But our final appointment, our 40-week appointment where we would talk induction and all that kind of stuff, was May 31st, and it was a Wednesday. His due date was June 1st. That Tuesday night, I was laying there in bed and by myself in bed, and I'm like, I have not felt him move in forever. I have not felt him move in forever. And I'd kind of been at work earlier that day, pushing on my stomach, and he didn't move. And so that night I'm laying there and I'm pushing and I'm pushing and I'm pushing on my stomach, just trying to do anything in my power to get him to move. And he didn't. I could kind of feel something moving in my stomach, and I kind of just told myself that he was fine, he was just sleeping, and I honestly rolled over and went to sleep. So that morning, I had a doctor's appointment. It was at 9 a.m. Wednesday, and I'm sitting on the couch and it's on my computer, and really, really nervous. My heart was in my throat. Craig came downstairs and was like, all right, let's get the show on the road. Maybe the baby will come today. Maybe he'll induce today. And I'm like, you know what? I just had an appointment on Friday. You know, baby's fine. You know, there's nothing going on. Let's just cancel. Let's just cancel. And he's like, no way. The baby could come today. And he kind of gave me a hug. And I just knew. I hadn't felt him move in a couple days. I hadn't told anybody. I didn't want reality to set in, because right then I was the only person that knew, and I knew that I was going to have to drag everybody else into this mess with me. And if he could just be inside of me, that nobody else would know, and we could just go on pretending for a few more days. So, I had to go to the appointment because I couldn't tell Craig all this stuff. And I was sitting in the waiting room, and I remember thinking, you know, just move, kiddo, just move, do something for me, anything, please. Didn't move, but we get called back, and I called us back, and I kind of said, you know, baby's not moving very much. And he said, okay, well, I'm gonna check you to see if you're dilated at all, and then, you know, they just don't move as much. And I was like, okay. And yeah, he checked me and he said, well, you're about a centimeter dilated. And he's sitting there and he's like, okay. And I lay back and he's gonna put the Doppler on my stomach, and I'm just like, here it comes, you know, and puts the Doppler on. And even if you don't find the heartbeat right away, you usually can hear placenta sounds. You can hear, you know, blood flowing through the uterus and things like that. And it was very, very quiet. And I remember there was a faint heartbeat in the distance, and he put his fingers on my wrist to feel for my pulse. And then he's like, okay, I'll be right back. I'm gonna go get the ultrasound machine. And I'm just laying there and I'm like, why? Why?
When the doctor was first not able to find the baby's heartbeat on the Doppler, I was worried. I was more worried than I showed to Chantel, probably. I was nervous about it. I wasn't in a panic yet. I didn't have the information that she had at that point about the movement and things. I was asking the doctor, you know, what could be going on, and I think he mentioned something about, you know, sometimes a baby has turned in a certain way where you can't hear it. So I was holding, I mean, that had to be it. That, you know, it's just he's turned in a certain way.
The doctor comes back in with the ultrasound machine, and I'm laying there and staring up at the ceiling, and I'm just like, this is gonna suck. I mean, it was just, I already knew. We needed that confirmation, obviously, and I was still holding out hope. I was still holding out for some miracle that, you know, it was still there, he just wasn't moving. And
when they came back in with the ultrasound machine and put the thing on her stomach, he delayed for a second. He didn't say anything. I was watching the screen and I was waiting and just, you know, praying for him to say something. Like, oh, okay, there's the heart. There's, you know, he's turned a certain way. And I could tell the doctor didn't know what to say. He said something like, there, you can see his little ribs or something like that. And, you know, I was starting to panic at that point, but I was gonna wait to hear it from the doctor himself before I was gonna give up hope. And that's when he said, as you can see, there's no heart activity. And at that point, I lost it.
I kind of looked over briefly at the machine and I looked back because I still remember I can see his little, you know, when you see an ultrasound, you can see the head and the body, and I could see his spine just kind of laying there, and he wasn't moving. There was no lung activity. There was no heart beating. And I just sat there, and I, you know, one of the thoughts was, well, that's why I felt the way I did. That's why I had the few thoughts. Another thought was I wanted my mom. And you know, part of it is I didn't want Craig to go through what I had already kind of been going through. I didn't want to hurt him, and I knew this was going to change our lives forever. So I remember Craig swearing very loudly.
I couldn't believe it. I didn't think it was possible. So it was just so sickening. If someone had cornered me at that point and asked me what I thought was going to happen next, I probably would have said there's going to be a C-section or some sort of operation, and we wouldn't ever see this baby, and we would go home today.
And I remember the doctor kind of sitting me up and saying, you know, well, a couple choices here, you know, I think I'm the one that started leading the conversation, actually, looking back on it. I think I said, I have to deliver him, and he goes, yes. And I said, I should probably deliver him today, and he goes, yes. And he said, do you want to go home first? And I remember thinking, for what? So I can walk into the house and see the baby swing I've set up and the outfit my mother-in-law just bought me laying on the kitchen counter. I'm like, why do I want to go home? It's the last place I wanted to go, really. But home wasn't comforting to me whatsoever. I said to Craig, I said, you know, to call our parents. And I was just like, it was like what I said, I want my mom. You know, I wanted my parents there. And so I pick up the phone and I call my parents' house. They had a little phone in the doctor's office. And I said, I've got to, you know, call my parents. And the phone rang and rang and rang, and nobody picked up. And so I called my dad's cell phone. And this was actually a lucky thing that happened, that I got a hold of him first so he could go to my mom. But I called him and I said, Daddy, we lost the baby. And he said, what? Because, you know, it's not the phone call you're expecting when your daughter's 40 weeks pregnant. I just said, you know, Daddy, you know, the baby's gone. We need you to come to the hospital. And I know he didn't understand. He goes, are you there now? I said, no, we're at the clinic. I mean, I'm sure there's so many questions swirling in their heads, but we didn't have the answers for him. And he said, you know, I'm on my way. And the phone hung up, and I know he flew out of his office. And my mom had been working nights. She was a flight attendant, and she was sleeping when I happened to call, and she had the ringer off. And I know to this day she feels bad that she didn't answer the phone, but I'm actually glad that my dad was there to be with her when she got the news.
I had to call my mom with the news from the clinic, and I called her, and she was in the car, and I probably should have told her to pull over before I gave her the news, but I didn't. I told her, I said, Mom, we lost the baby. And I remember her saying, oh, Craig, that's so sad. And she was crying, and I was crying, and I said, you need to come to the hospital. You and Dad need to come to the hospital. We need you.
I didn't want anybody in the hospital waiting for me to give birth before. I wanted to call people, say the baby's here, come see us. But it's different. You know, it's different when you lose the baby. You want all your support in the world. And Craig and I have absolutely fabulous parents, and I wanted them there. And we got into Craig's car. We left my car at the clinic, and we got into Craig's car. And I looked in the back seat, and there was the base for the car seat installed right there. And I kind of shook my head. I was already kind of starting to feel angry and disbelief. And I just looked at it and shook my head, like, what were we thinking installing the car seat base? What was the point of that?
I had to call my work and obviously let them know that I wasn't gonna be in the office that day. And this is one of the things I think about, how this conversation went, and I kind of regret the way I said it or what it was implied, because when the receptionist at my work answered, she immediately recognized my voice and she said, "You know, are you a new father yet?" And assuming that that's why I was calling, because I wasn't gonna come in because, you know, the baby had been born. And what I said to her wasn't true, but it was the only thing that came to my mind. I said, "That's not gonna happen."
Then we went to the hospital. We walked in the doors and looked at the, you know, it said labor and delivery this way, and we'd been up on the floor already, so we went up and they walked to a room, and it's just a total blur, but I remember walking down this hall, I remember getting to the door, and there was this fake white rose with a purple ribbon taped to the door, and kind of looked at it and didn't mean much to me at the time, but in hindsight, that's what the hospital does for, so anybody entering that room knows that there's been a loss, because, you know, you're on the labor and delivery floor, and you know, for the most part, people walking in are gonna be like, "Oh, your baby's so cute." You know, it's usually a happy place, and so they definitely make it known before anybody walks in, whether it's food service people or maintenance people, that something tragic has happened in that room. And we walked in, and it was just Craig and I, and spread out on the bed was all this information. It said, you know, surviving the death of your baby, and fetal demise, and all this stuff, and there's this little box, and it was all spread out very nicely, and I looked at it, and I was like, "Oh my gosh, are you kidding me?" I'm like, look at this, and I took the stuff, and I kind of flung it on the counter, and I was just mad at it. I was just like, I just thought it was ridiculous that it was sitting there, and just glaring in my face that, you know, your baby's dead, and now you got to deal with it. I just, it was the last thing I wanted. And this nurse came in, and she sat down on the bed, and she said, you know, her name was Kim, and she came in to help us out, and she is part of the fetal demise program at the hospital, and her and this other nurse kind of headed up, and they are comfortable dealing with situations like this, basically. And that did make me feel good that she was not uncomfortable, because she said, you know, some nurses really struggle, and they don't sit with the patient, and they don't, you know, they just, it's really difficult for those nurses. And she's, you know, I'm okay with everything, and I'm gonna talk with you, I'm gonna help you through this. And she's sitting there, and she was rubbing my hand, and kept staring at her wrist, so she's kind of talking, but all I could focus on was, she had a turtle bracelet on, just, you know, simple silver bracelet with turtles all over it. And, you know, turtles are kind of my thing, and turtles were in Curtis's room, and I had the turtle onesies, and so I just remember, like, oh my gosh. And she stepped out for a second, and I said to Craig, she's got turtles on her bracelet. She's got turtles on her bracelet. You know, just with that little sign, it was just a little bit of hope, and a little bit of, like, you know, this person's gonna get you through. And she explained to us that, you know, I would be induced like any other pregnant woman, that I could have an epidural, and given the situation, they could give me a strong epidural, so to keep me out as much physical pain as possible. You know, he'd be born, and she's like, you know, maybe we'll know right away what happened. Maybe there'll be something obvious, and maybe there won't. That he was gonna look like any other baby. You know, he was, she said they'd probably be able to tell how long he'd been gone. And, you know, I kind of started asking her about some of her other patients. I said, you know, have you had other patients? Have they had other children? And she's like, yeah, she's had a few patients that have gone on and been lucky enough to have, you know, living children. And it made me feel good. It's in this setting, you're so clinging for hope. You just want somebody to tell you that 3, 4, 10 years down the road, that life will be better. You won't be sitting in this absolute hell that you're in at that moment. When Kim was kind of getting everything ready for the induction to start, my parents showed up first. My mom walked in, and no makeup on, nothing on. She'd obviously woken up, and she'd already been sobbing. You could already tell. And, you know, they came over, they gave me a hug. And I know that they had, later on, I found out, you know, the car on the way over, my mom just kept saying, you know, I feel bad for Craig. Chantel's had that baby for 9 months and Craig hasn't had him at all yet. There's a knock on the door. They said, oh, some grandparents are here. And I was actually thinking at that time it would be Craig's parents, that they just said that they were the grandparents of the baby, but actually my grandma and grandpa walked in, and my grandpa couldn't even look at me. He was so upset.
My dad was having an especially hard time with this. When my parents came to the hospital and I met them, it was strange for me because I don't think I've ever seen my dad cry. Certainly I'd never seen him cry to the extent that he was upset that day. They were both crying and they both gave me a hug, and they wanted to know what happened. I remember my dad crying and saying, what happened? And I said, I don't know.
I remember, you know, them going through, you know, starting the induction process. I remember that. I remember the anesthesiologist coming in and, you know, putting the needle in my back and I had to bend over and hold myself. And, you know, it went really well. And I just remember, like, sitting up from it and looking at Craig and saying, how do people live through this? Probably drugs and alcohol. We laughed like we do. It's Craig and I always kind of joke in tough situations. And then I had to clarify with people. I'm like, you know, I'm not going to turn to that. It's okay. Because I was just, you know, worried that they were going to send the psychologist in right away because I'd made this joke. And, you know, I also remember some of the time talking to Craig saying, I'm so glad we have a dog. I'm so glad we are going to go home to something happy to see us and something to greet us. And then I also said to him, you know, can we take a trip sometime soon? I was so busy trying to focus on something good in the future, and because everything we had planned for had been taken away very quickly. You know, we weren't thinking about vacations and things like that. We were thinking about babies and sleepless nights and diaper changes. The induction started around noon, and it was going very, very well. My body was ready. My doctor came in and he broke my water at some point, and he said that there was, it's basically, you know, the baby who has a bowel movement in utero, and that's harmful to the baby if they're living. That's a sign if that happens, that the baby's been in distress, because usually the baby passes that after they're born.